Mina, ohayou gozaimasu, Jesus Freaking Gamer here. Yes, ohayou gozaimasu, Monday morning, and I was supposed to make up for last Sunday's message, which I didn't. Running behind, yet again. Surprise! It's not a surprise at this point. I am as consistent as running mashed potatoes or spaghetti. I hate that. I'll just have to keep on working on it. I'm not going to give up. I'm going to keep on succeeding, or keep on failing until I succeed. I'm going to keep on succeeding until I ultimately succeed. Something like that. I don't know what I'm talking about. Hopefully I know a little bit of what I'm talking about. Otherwise, this 30-minute message won't be good. But actually, speaking of which, this 30-minute message is something that I don't entirely know about. It's not something I'm entirely sure about. And what I decided to talk about today for the 30-minute message was God's eternalness, His everlastingness. I forget the exact name of that attribute of God, but I actually have a little book here. I have it has a lot of good verses in it. Going to go over that. Also going to talk about the creation, how that fits in the whole thing, a little bit of theory on time. And a disclaimer there. I actually, when I was in high school and college, I never took a single calculus class, never took a single physics class, never took a single quantum mechanics class. So I don't know about other dimensions, other worlds, how all the different elements of this physical universe fit together, the various theories upon which everything works, according to what man currently knows. And I don't know exactly how time itself works. I know E equals MC squared, energy equals mass times the speed of light squared. I know that. Don't know how to unpack that exactly, but I'm going to do my best here. So God's eternity. It was just, I was thinking about it, and I was like, you know, covered all the omnis. I don't know if anyone's ever covered God as far as time goes. So why don't I give that a shot just for this one video? I mean, heck, it's not, I don't know everything. I've never professed to know everything. And even though I do try to know a little bit of something before I speak on a topic, at the exact same time, sometimes it's really helpful if I talk about it, talk about what I do know, discuss what I think I may know, some of the theories about things that I don't know, and then the people who hear the message, they can reciprocate. We have comment sections in YouTube. It's a wonderful thing. By all means, throw in your thoughts, your opinions, maybe even a rebuke or a correction if I said something completely and totally wrong. Let me know whether it has to do with the Bible, whether it has to do with math or science. Just let me know. And for those of you who aren't Christians and you're like, yeah, the whole God concept is wrong, feel free to troll me in the comments down below. I don't plan on blocking or banning anyone for like, this guy's an idiot, he believes in God. Have no intention of banning you people. Your meanness and your harshness and your trolliness can stay in the comments section for all of eternity, for all I care. Don't really care too much about that. I have no problem being trolled or being criticized. Sometimes, honestly, it's a little bit fun. Sometimes it's a little bit on the fun side. So, all of that said, let's hop into this. I'm like, where should I start with the scripture? Should I start with something else? You know, I'm actually going to start with, before I get into the scriptures, let's talk about eternity and everlasting and what exactly that means. The first term that comes to mind when we have eternity and everlasting, the basic way to define those things is something that never ends. Another word closely associated with eternity and everlasting is infinity. Again, it's one more word that means something never ends. There may be subtle nuances between the three. There may be different terminologies for the three, but all three essentially mean the same thing. One big definition difference would be in the term infinity. That is an actual calculus term. And it means exactly what it says on the tin. It's forever. It's infinity. There is no end. If you add, subtract, multiply, or divide any number by infinity, the end result is still infinity. You can't add anything to it. It's already infinite. And no matter how much you subtract from it, you can't get less than infinity because infinity keeps on going. So no matter how much you take, there's always something there. And you multiply it all you want. It's already infinite. You can't really add anything to it. Divide however much from it you want. You can't take away anything from it. Now, when it comes to like infinity times infinity or infinity plus infinity, I don't know how those particular formulas work. But with this mindset, it's a little bit easier to grasp what it means when the Bible says God is everlasting or eternal, or he is infinite in one of his attributes. Like I've covered the omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent. It basically means he is infinitely powerful, infinitely knowledgeable, and infinitely present everywhere. He is infinite in those capacities. So God's eternity or eternal attribute, I guess you could say he is infinite in his time or his timeliness. It's kind of weird. I don't know why there's not like an omni-time talked about anywhere. Or that there is, if there is a term for that, I've never heard a preacher use it, and I didn't look up a term for that ahead of time. Like, I wonder if this term exists. I didn't look it up. You know what I did look up, though? On the last message that I preached, where we actually got into a little bit of nebulous stuff, God's omnipresence, and I was like, this kind of doesn't make a ton of sense. I can kind of get it, but I kind of don't. And I talked about another thing that I kind of got and I kind of didn't. And that was the geometry terms that discuss like something that goes infinitely in both directions and infinitely in one direction. I did look that up this time, and I have that looked up right here and now. Now, the word that I remembered was align, and that's the one that best describes God, because he goes backwards and forwards infinitely. So align, geometrically speaking, it's straight, it has no curves, and when you're on a bar graph, that's very, very important. Not super duper important for this analogy. It has no thickness, so it's not like a dimensionally spaced thing. You don't measure it by, you know, how thick it is or how broad it is. You just measure it in how far it goes. And the most important for this definition in terms of who God is, it extends in both directions without end. It is infinite this way. I'll make sure I'm on camera. It's infinite this way and this way. It just keeps on going. Now the term, and there are also things apparently that I completely forgot about called line segments, where you have two dots on the line, and the space, however long or short it is between those two dots, that's a line segment. Excuse me. So you have this limited line, so to speak. And then the term that I completely forgot, it's array, where you have a point, and then the line starts and it goes on forever. Yeah, I guess it can go in any direction, but it has a definite starting point. But it goes infinitely in one direction. That is array. For some reason, I feel a little bit more complete now that I've recalled that term. Thank you, websites. Thank you, internet, for giving me some basic geometry that I had forgotten from long, long times ago. So I would say, and the Bible would say, that all humans are rays. We have a definite starting point. We were all born at some point, we're all going to die, but then we're all going into eternity. And I've discussed in the Heaven and Hell series how the Christians go into heaven, the non-Christians go into hell. And if you are interested or want to talk about those points, feel free to, you can leave a comment in actually this video if you want to talk about anything whatsoever, whether it's this topic or another topic. If you leave a comment in some video from months ago, there is a very good chance I won't see it or will not pay attention to it. So feel free to criticize anything I say in this comment section down below, because chances are good, like for the next several days or whatever, I will see it here and respond to it. If you're interested in the topic and maybe more that I've talked about in regards to heaven and hell, see those respective messages in my, is it in my Bible playlist yet? I don't know, but it is on my channel. If you search heaven or hell on my channel, you should find those messages discussed there. So if you want information there, go there. So I won't belabor those particular points. Excuse me, but yes. So we have the line and we have the ray. We're all rays. We go on forever and ever, whether you're a Christian or not, whether you enjoy where you go or not. You are still an infinite being, an everlasting or an eternal being, in the sense that you'll go on forever. But God is an eternal and everlasting being from both directions. He has no beginning and he has no end. That's really hard to wrap my mind around, but the Bible declares it, so I believe it. And in all honesty, to me personally, there had to be a first cause somewhere. Something had to kick off this entire event called our existence and our reality. And to say that matter is eternal does not make sense to me. When I see everything around me deteriorating, moving from order to chaos, I find it very hard to believe that somehow matter is infinite. Matter deteriorates over time. Things get less orderly over time. Things die over time. Even if you look into the grander spectrum of the universe, stars themselves, they die after so much amount of time. Things on every single level, from big to small, things deteriorate and they stop moving and they stop functioning over time. They don't get better. They don't improve. They don't somehow revive and come back. They just disappear. They just fade away. So infinite matter, even if I wasn't a Christian, I guess if I had nothing else, I would buy that. But if there's any theory other than that out there, I'd probably choose, again, if I wasn't a Christian, I'd probably choose a deistic or a theistic approach, not an atheistic or an agnostic approach. You know, something kicked all of this off. Something other than this current reality kicked this reality off. Something else other than matter is eternal. And really, there's no way to prove that. That's where faith comes in. So you feel free to believe or not believe whatever you wish. I do not believe that matter is infinite and just came out, has always existed. I believe that someone else, prior to this current creation, set everything in order and got the chain reaction of events going that is our current reality. That makes the most sense to me. So with that in mind, with those basic terms and concepts in mind, let's get into a little bit of Scripture and what the Scripture says about God's eternity and about who He is and His eternalness. Going to cover some of the classic verses, going to cover some things that maybe aren't incredibly classic, but let's hop into this. Now, I'm like, where should I start? Actually, let's start at the very beginning, Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In case you don't know, Genesis is the very first book of the Bible. Chapter 1, verse 1 is the very first chapter and first verse of that book. You're welcome. Glad I could help. A little bit of a troll even in my preaching videos. I can get behind a little bit of trolling here and there. So Genesis 1, verse 1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning, God. Now, and I've heard this preached by several different preachers on several different occasions. In the beginning, God. You really don't need much more than that. In the beginning of everything, God. I don't personally quite buy that. I'm not quite in that. I mean, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Yes, in the beginning, before anything else was, there was God. Yes, but for this verse to prove it, it doesn't really say that. If you interpreted it in a very literalistic sense, well, one, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That doesn't speak of when God started or when God was formed. It just speaks of when the heavens and the earth were formed. And they were their start, their origination was God. It doesn't really speak of God's origin or God's beginning or who created God. It speaks of the heavens and the earth's origin and who created them. So to me, that verse is insufficient. Also, another very popular one quoted is Exodus 3:14. Let's turn over to there. As always, I love flipping my pages and using an actual book. Probably, I always have so far, and I probably always will. So Exodus 3, verse 14. And God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, I am has sent me to you. And a lot of preachers will use this verse to say God calls himself I am, not I was or I will be, I am. God is eternally in the moment. He's eternally here. There was never a point where God could not say I am. As always, I apologize for the amount of yawns. Since it's morning time for me, this is very late into my day. So, you know, a little bit of yawning going on here. I apologize for that. Unfortunately, that's pretty normal for my 30-minute messages. Not to mention the fact that I'm asthmatic, so continuous talking and usage of my breath probably contributes to that as well. And all I can say is I'm sorry, and moving right along. And then there's, of course, the comfort of I am, so wherever you are, at whatever time it is, I am. He's always there. I do like the comfort in that. And based on other biblical passages, I've talked about God's omnipotence, omniscience, and omnipresence. So, you know, where he is, what he knows, and what he can do, those things are covered. But honestly, the whole I am, to draw all of those things that I just said out of I am, to me, that is also not helpful. I don't quite buy into it. I believe in those concepts because of other verses, but just to say I am has sent me to you, that is incredibly ambiguous to me, and I don't know exactly what that means. I am. What does that mean? What does that even mean? I believe in the things that I just said based off of other verses. I would not gather all of those things and take them to the bank, fully believe them, based off of just this verse. This verse needs severe unpacking. I am, does that refer to who God is as a person? Does it refer to what he can do? Does it refer to his type of being? Where his being is in a certain state of time? What does that mean? Maybe it means all of that. Maybe it means some of it. Maybe it means none of it. So as far as a proof text to say this is what I believe about God, that verse honestly doesn't help me. It doesn't. Some Christians may be offended by that statement and say I have a lack of faith. I certainly do need to grow in my faith. I will agree with that. But it's not helpful as far as helping direct me to who God is and what he can do. If you were to direct me to what he does right after this, starting to deliver the children of Israel, oh, God has quite a bit of power. Oh, he's much stronger than the gods of Egypt. Oh, he's right there with the children of Israel. Those things are much more helpful to me in defining who he is. God says, I am. I know who he is based on what he has said and what he has done. So I am, that I am is a lot, that I am is a lot of stuff. When he says, you know, I am your healer, I am your deliverer, I am your savior, I am the one who brings everlasting life. Those things make a lot more sense because then I know who he is based on what he does and what he says. So I am, it's a great, I may be using the wrong term here, a great prepositional phrase. It's a good setup for who he is. But it doesn't in and of itself state who he is. And you can't say God is everything because God isn't sinful. And he is not a tempter of sin. The Bible makes those things clear. He is not those things. He is not everything. And God is not part of his creation. He is the one who created everything, as we just talked about in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. So that verse also is not incredibly helpful to me. No, so to move on, let's go into Isaiah 43:10. This will start laying a foundation for where God got his start, so to speak. Isaiah 43:10. You are my witnesses, says the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe me, and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, nor shall there be after me. Now that's some specific information. Before him, there was no God formed. So there wasn't a God before him. There was no. It doesn't speak of anything else that could have existed before him. But it does say, there was no God before him. Nor shall there be after me. There was no God before him. There won't be a God after him. That is much more specific. That tells me a bit of who he is in relation to time, in relation to this present reality. We know that the heavens and the earth, they were created by God. And now we also know, and all of this, of course, is based on the presupposition that we can believe this God. This God says he doesn't lie. Do you believe that or not? I personally believe that. I think this God is a very honest guy. I think we can believe what he says. And I believe that we can take every single word he says to the bank. So God created the heavens and the earth. There wasn't a God before him. There wasn't a God after him. You know what that sounds like? God went infinitely, as far back as it goes, God existed. He doesn't really speak of his origin or what made him, but he does say that there wasn't a God before him. In our present reality, the heavens and the earth, those were created by God. So we have creation, us, and then there's God. We don't. Is there a creation apart from him? The Bible doesn't address that. All it says is that our creation, where we currently are, that does come from our God. And God said that there isn't a God before him or a God after him. So what it sounds like is everything that was created by him, and that there was no God, and there was no God before him and no God after him. So it sounds very likely that God had no beginning, he has no end, and everything that exists was created by him. Though that I can use as a proof text. That makes a lot more sense to me. That isn't ambiguous. That isn't, I'm not sure about that. Again, if I'm going to try to draw a conclusion from anything, I want to be as sure as I possibly can be. And I want whatever is stated to be stated as clearly as it can possibly be stated so that I don't misunderstand. Another text here would be Psalm 90, verse 2. Past it. Psalm 90, verse 2. This is a prayer of Moses. So this psalm comes from Moses. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. From eternity to eternity, you are God. That sounds a bit weird, but with the concept of a line, and then like our reality, our existence would be a point on that line, we kind of have a context. So we're here, and then there's infinitely before us and infinitely after us. For me, the geometric concept of a line helps me to kind of place this a lot better. So here we are, infinitely before us, infinitely after us, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Again, that helps us narrow it down a little bit more, who he is and what he does. God has no beginning, has no end. He is infinitely in both directions. It's a bit hard for me to wrap my mind around. It makes a lot more sense than infinite matter. And that also speaks of who God's person is. God doesn't have a beginning. He doesn't have an end. He is a truly eternal being. Whereas we're eternal in the sense that we will last forever from whatever point of origin we have, of course, as humans, that's birth. God doesn't have an origin story. He doesn't have a beginning. He goes infinitely that way. Infinitely. It doesn't stop. So we have a God who is infinite as far as time goes. There are a lot of theories of time that I don't understand and I can't really begin to unpack because of a lack of understanding. But to attempt just a little bit, it strikes me as the fact that time is very much so a creation of God. Like if God is outside of his creation, he's separate from his creation, he created all that there is, and he goes infinitely forwards and backwards, then time, it sounds like, was one of his inventions. He doesn't exist in time. He's an eternal being. He has no beginning or end. So as beings who have beginnings and ends in this world, eternity is... it's hard for it to be more than just a concept for us. It's almost like something we use to try to understand the world around us. And indeed, calculus has led to the invention of several other things. Without the concept of infinity and what that can do for us mathematically, there are several inventions that we currently have that we would not have. We needed the concept of infinity. And God is the originator of that concept. Right, actually, I'll say God's the originator of the concept of infinity for us, but for God, who is an infinite being, for whatever reason, he was like, you know what? I'm going to create time. I'm going to create limits and boundaries. And of course, we can look in all of creation, and there is no infinity here in this creation. Everything has a beginning and an end. Everything has a limit. Everything has things it can do and can't do. Everything is bound in some way, and time is a huge limiter for us humans. We have 24 hours in a day. We have 7 days in a week. We have 365 days or 52 weeks in a year. 10 years in a decade, 100 years in a century, 1,000 years in a millennium, and usually less than 100 years in a human lifetime. Time is a limiter for us. God has created several boundaries, time being one of them. And if I understand correctly, time itself actually slows down as you approach the speed of light. So the faster you're going, the slower time itself goes. So time is an incorporation of this reality. Time itself can be manipulated and bent to a degree, although for the most part it is way beyond a human's ability and bounds to grasp and control. Who knows what science will bring us in the future? I'll be very interested to see. But time is a part of this current reality. It can be understood. It can even be manipulated to an extent. But it is something within the bounds of this reality. Even time itself apparently has limits. There are things that can be done to maybe not influence it, but there are things that we can do to influence objects within time. And so, again, I'm trying to wrap my mind around this concept of who God is and how he's eternal and how he just kind of keeps on going, but he goes in both directions. Of course, with God, I've used the concept of a line, or an array being us, a line being God, to explain how reality itself works. But a line, by definition, is a two-dimensional thing. It doesn't even go in all three directions. It goes left and right. It doesn't even go up and down, much less in and out in a three-dimensional way. And since time is also a concept, I would have to say that three dimensions, or I guess four dimensions with time being the fourth dimension, even three dimensions is a concept. It's a part of reality. And it's really hard to imagine something outside of our current reality. It's really hard to imagine something outside of our own concept, out of our own reality, out of our own being. But why, if God created time and God created our three dimensions, why should he be limited to any of that? And considering how big he is like I discussed in the omnipotence video, all the things that God's created, it doesn't really surprise me or strike me as a huge deal that God could have dimensions way beyond time or the three dimensions in which we operate. Again, technically four, since time is also a boundary, a dimension in which we operate. If God, he didn't just go infinitely in both directions, what if he went infinitely in infinite directions? What if time is, I've already said time is simply a construct, but what if time itself is something incredibly small and like insignificant to God? And of course, if he's an infinite being, he would be. It's just all the things that we live in, the three dimensions we live in, the fourth dimension of time we live in, they're so real. Like, I need to go to bed soon. I need to get ready, for work later on today. Because when the time comes, I need to be at my job, punched in, ready to work. There's no escaping that for me as a human. Apart from a miracle like Enoch or Elijah, I'll die one day. I don't have an infinite lifespan in this world, in this body, in this reality. That is also a limitation. But God has none of these limitations. So it's almost like for God to be, and when I think of it in that way, for God to be infinite in one direction and infinite in another, that's a small thing for him. He's infinite in all kinds of directions and such. He's infinite in all ways, way beyond these three dimensions and the fourth dimension of time. God's so far beyond all of that. So, yeah, there's the sermon on God's eternity, God's eternalness, God, that infinite time factor of his. Time is a construct, time's a part of this reality. Space-time is a term you will see in physics, because again, time is something that is manipulable, or at least objects are manipulable within it. I'm not sure if we can manipulate time, but we have... I know we have sent a satellite into orbit with a very, very fine-tuned clock on it, and we sent it around. It's not going at the speed of light. We don't have anything that goes at the speed of light except for light. But yeah, once it approached certain speeds, really super-duper fast in orbit, When we looked at the clock on this thing, sure enough, over time, it lost seconds. It lost minutes. It was going so fast that time slowed down. So that object was manipulated within time. So as a part of our reality, and one of the restrictions that we operate in, it can be manipulated. It can be bent, so to speak. So for God to be way above that and way beyond that, and completely above that, I don't know, just as I've talked about it and thought about it, I feel like I get God's eternity a little bit more than I did before. So hopefully this was helpful. Hopefully this took you in directions that your brain hadn't gone in before. It helped me out just thinking it through and talking about it. So thank you guys very much for being here and watching this with me. And I don't want to end a single message without this. We're going a little over 30 minutes. You usually go a little over 30 minutes anyway. But guys, I want to give everyone the possibility right now to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. If you want to believe in this infinite God that I've talked about, if you want to devote your life to Him, if you want your sins forgiven, all you've got to do is believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. This message didn't really lead to a salvation message, except for to say God is so big and we are so small. And we need Him. And I probably don't need to convince many of us that you're sinners. I'm a sinner. You're a sinner. We're all sinners. We've all done things that are wrong. We've all done things that have fallen short of this great and glorious God who created us. And that's why Jesus died on the cross for us. That's why He shed His blood and rose again so that we could be forgiven our sins and have our eternity be with Him in heaven. We're eternal beings. There are two choices, heaven or hell. And it's our call where we want to go. And right now, I'm giving you the chance to be in heaven with that God forever if you will accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And if you want to do that, just ask Him that. And if you want some words to follow, like a model prayer, let me give that to you right now. Pray this prayer with me and mean it from your heart. Say, Lord Jesus, I admit that I'm a sinner. Please forgive me for my sins. I believe You died on the cross, and I believe You rose again. Please right now forgive me of all my sins, and please be my God, my Master, and my Savior. Thank You, Jesus. Amen. And if you prayed that prayer in a minute, congratulations. You are one of the family. Welcome to the Church of the Living God. If I can encourage you, read this a little bit every day. It'll get you thinking along the lines of how your God thinks. Go to a church. It's great and helpful to be around people who believe the same things as you do. Find a church that believes that Jesus Christ is God, Lord, and Savior. Find a church that believes that the Bible is the Word of God and that you can depend and rely on it. And lastly, shoot up a little prayer to God every single day. Even if it's a simple little prayer of thank you, God, for this day, or God, this day sucks. Please help me get through it. God hears those prayers, He cares about those prayers, and He answers those prayers. Guys, thank you very much for watching this video. I love you, and God bless.